talk a little more about linearization and linear approximation of functions, or tangent line approximation. So what we had discussed and defined in the previous video was the fact that a function can be approximated by its tangent line close to a point when we look at the tangent line at that point. And so what we're saying here is, this is our just a restatement of what we talked about in the last video, and that is that a function is approximately equal to its tangent line. This is just the equation of a tangent line. Nothing new for us at this point. We've looked at tangent lines for weeks and weeks. So, and at length talked about how to find them by finding a derivative to find the slope, and then writing the equation of a line. So this is just the tangent line. And what linearization allows us to do, this process of linearizing a function at a point, is it lets us use that linear equation, that tangent line equation, to approximate the function close to the point we drew in the tangent line at, or found the tangent line at. So let's look at one more example with that, and then expand on that a little further into this concept called differentials. So let's start first with just one more example. This one, rather than having a function, all we know, so this really gets at kind of the actual conceptual piece of what it means to linearize a function. So all we know in this particular example is that we have a function, and that f of 1 equals negative 3. So we know that the value of the function at x equals 1 is negative 3. And then we're actually given not the graph of the function, but the graph of the derivative. So here's the graph of the derivative, and I'm going to highlight that f prime of x. That is not the function. That is a graph of the derivative of the function. So that is actually a graph of the slopes of the tangent lines to the function, and not the actual function itself. So then it says use linear approximation to estimate two values. So before we get into the estimation, let's talk about the linear approximation. So what we've just talked about is the fact that f of x can be approximated by its tangent line. So it can be approximated by f prime of a times x minus a plus f of a. Now that comes right out of the tangent line and just saying, you know, y minus f of a equals f prime of a, the slope, times x minus a, and then we just add the f of a over, and then we say y is f of x. Okay, so that's where all that comes from, but that is just our tangent line. And so what we could say here is we could say, well, f of x is approximately, this would be at, I guess we should be specific, at x equals 1, or near x equals 1, near the point we're looking at, which is x equals 1, near x equals 1, f of x would be approximately equal to f prime of 1 times x minus 1 plus a negative 3, right, negative 3 like that. So that means that f of x is going to be approximately, well, what is f prime of 1? How would I find that? Well, if I had a graph, I could, if all I had was a graph of the function, I could draw in a tangent line at 1 and look for the slope. But I don't have the function. I have the derivative. So if I want to know what f prime of 1 is, it's even easier. I just say, well, what is f prime of 1? F prime of 1 is, in fact, 2. Okay, so I just go to 1, and I look up here, and I notice that f prime of 1 right here, f prime of 1 is equal to 2. So this is just 2 times x minus 1 plus a negative, of course. Let's just write that as minus 3. So that means that the function itself is approximately 2x minus 5. So we don't know what this function is. We don't have a graph of it. We knew very little, actually, about the function. All we knew was a point that it passed through and a graph of its derivative. So, but what we can do is now we can say that this function is equal to approximately 2x minus 5 when we are close, when x is close to 1. Well, 0.9 and 1.1 are awfully close to 1. So it would be appropriate to use this line to approximate those values. So let's do it. So what would f of 0.9 be approximately? Well, 2 times 0.9 minus 5. So 1.8 minus 5. So that would be about 3.2. And how about 1.1? Well, that would be approximately 2 times 1.1 minus 5, and that would be 2.2 minus 5. That would be approximately 2.8. And look at how quickly, even without knowing a whole lot about the function, we were able to approximate two values of the function by using this process of linearization. So those are approximations. And of course, we don't have the function, so we can't come up with the exact values, but those are approximations. And it uses this idea of a tangent line, using a tangent line, a linear function, to make those approximations. Another concept coming out of tangent lines and differentials, coming out of tangent lines and linearization, is this concept of differentials. And so what is a differential? Well, it's just another way to linearize the function, another way to think of this. So remember that in Leibniz notation, we say dy dx is equal to f prime of x, equal to Newton's notation, f prime of x. And so now what we're actually going to do is we're going to get in and we're going to think of this as a ratio and talk about what does that ratio actually represent. So couple of graphical explanations, definitions here. Delta x is the change in x. So when we have a graph, and what I have over here on the right side here is we have the graph y equals f of x in black. So y is equal to f of x. And the red line is our tangent line. So this is the tangent. At a point, and we're looking at it at a specific point. And if we look at another point on the curve, so we start at P and we look at another point Q on the curve, the difference between those two points, the difference horizontally between those two points, is called delta X, the change in X, the horizontal change in X. So this distance here in my graph is called delta X. That is the difference between the two points. Delta y, horizontal distance between the two points. Delta y is the change in y. It's the vertical change in the function. So delta y is this length from the vertical change as we move from P to Q. So delta x is the horizontal change. Delta y is the vertical change. Now our differentials come from the change on the tangent line. So dx is the horizontal change as we move, again, between those two spaces, P and Q. It's the horizontal change, and I'm going to try to draw it right on here as well in red. That is dx. Notice that dx and delta x are actually equal. Okay, dx and delta x are equal. Now, dy is the change in y, the vertical change on the tangent line. And notice that that is not the same. Again, I'm going to try to draw that kind of in a bold red here so you can see that. That is dy. Okay? So it's the vertical change on the tangent line as we move from one point to another. So dy is the change in y, the vertical change on the tangent line. So, you know, in terms of our linearization, when we use a tangent line to approximate a curve, the closer we are to the actual point where we drew in the tangent line, the closer we are in this scenario to P, the better an approximation the tangent line is to the curve. Because of course, as we get further away, the gap between the tangent line drawn at a point and the actual curve can get further apart. And we can see that. That's the difference between delta y and dy, the differential dy. We can see that there's quite a gap here in this particular scenario. So you can see that gap is this gap that I'm talking about. And as we move further, I had to zoom out, of course, so we could draw those in. But as we were to move further and further away, we'd see that gap widening. Okay, and as we move further this direction, we would see that gap getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Okay, so our delta y and our dy, as we get make the gap in delta x dx smaller, then our delta y and our dy are going to be closer approximations of each other. So we can actually think of, and this is important down here, we can actually think of dx as the independent variable. We think of dx as independent, and then dy is just f prime of x dx. And it depends, of course, on what dx is. Okay? So our differential dy actually depends on our differential dx. So, and that's what I was just mentioning, right? As we change dx and the width of dx, then dy, of course, is going to also change as well. Okay, So if we just go back to our scenario from our, this was actually our very first example. This is kind of a zoom in here. This was the curve. Here was actually the cube root of x plus 1, and we had used the tangent line y equals 1/3 x. We'd come up with, we actually came up with the tangent line y equals 1/3 x plus 1 to make approximations. And so if we were to talk about drawing those in, and it's a little bit hard to do that, it's going to get a little pixelated as I zoom in, but if we were to do just kind of a rough graph of this between two, let's go out a little ways so that we have some distance to look at. If we were to look at, call this our P and this our Q, this distance here is delta X, this distance here is delta Y, and between those, that same, I covered up my black when I did that, so let me redraw that underneath. There's my DX. And my dy is this length from here to here up to the tangent line. And so we can see, right, I drew it out so that we would have some distance and we could actually see those quantities. Delta x is the change in x on the function, and dx is the change in x on the tangent line. Delta y is the change of y values on the function, and dy is the change in the y values on the tangent line. And so we can see both of that here. And notice, you know, this little notation here, these are using our actual tangent line to make approximations would give us over approximations, because the tangent line is above the function here. It's over approximating the function when we use our tangent line. Okay, so let's go ahead and do a little example or two, maybe if we have time, with our differentials. Okay, so let's find the differential dy of y equals cosine pi x. That's in parentheses, so cosine of pi x. So let's find this differential. So remember that the differential is equal to f prime of x dx. And that's coming from, you know, we're literally saying dy dx is f prime of x. And then we're thinking of this as that ratio. We're thinking of this as those changes in the tangent line, those physical changes in the tangent line. And so we're actually saying that this, you know, when dx is not zero, of course, that we can multiply both sides by dx, and dy would be f prime of dx. So if this is our function, finding the differential dy is simply a derivative problem. So we're going to be taking the derivative. So the derivative of cosine is minus sine of pi x times pi. But we're taking the differential, right? We're looking for the differential. We're not looking for dy dx. So we would have times dx. And then we would say that dy is negative pi sine of pi x dx. And that is my differential. Now, if we want to evaluate it for a specific point, if we want to know, so if we actually want to know, right, like on the graph, like of cosine of pi x, right, if we want to know at x equals 1/3, we actually want to know what that dy would be on that graph. If we were to use that graph to come up with that, then we just evaluate it. We already have dy, so this is just kind of a plug and chug. Minus pi sine of pi times 1/3 times 0.1. dx is 0.1. And that is negative pi. This becomes sine of pi over 3. So root 3 over 2. Root 3 over 2. I said it, wrote it wrong. And then 0.1 is just 1/10, so I'm just going to write that as 1/10. And so then this would be, looking to see if we can simplify anything, but we can't, minus pi root 3 over 20, which would be approximately, we might as well come up with that as approximately, that would be, I did not do that on my calculator ahead of time, so let me pop it in real quick. That's approximately negative 0.272. So we have the exact and the approximation for that differential dy evaluated at that specific point. So just, you know, I guess a bit of a renaming of what we've been talking about, and actually thinking of our dy dx as a ratio, a slope that we're breaking apart, and dy depends on whatever dx is. Dy becomes our dependent variable in this scenario, and it depends on what dx is. So dy being dependent, just like y depends on x in most scenarios, and dx is independent. So seeing an illustration of that. So again, this whole section is not anything new, just sort of renaming and talking about the uses of some of the things that we've had. And so now we have this idea of differentials, and we can use differentials and ask for the differential dy of a specific function, and we can find that.